Hi guys, I just wanted to make a video to try and like sit down and explain how you know, my experience with contending with the devil was Satan, one of his angels, or one of him, you know, himself, because I never really sat down and disclosed it all. I dropped it into a few of my videos back in August when this happened. It was around my birthday, because well, he knew it was my birthday because he was mentioning it. And I suppose it's something that I want to like sort of take my time a little bit and you know, try and explain things properly, like, but. I don't know if it's... I got over it quick, if you know what I mean. Because afterwards, well, this was an incredible, evil, sort of stressful time, you know. And then straight afterwards, when it finished, what came in was just like love and ecstasy. Not just me, but like everyone around me. Or it seemed like everyone around me. It was all like a, it was almost like there was a choir or an army of angels around me at the time, because everyone was happy and people were looking and smiling, and people smiling and everything else. And it was just sort of like an ecstasy afterwards. So it was like a really bad and then balance of really good. But obviously this is spiritual, not an accident. And it just ends. The very thing that reminded me in the Bible was where actually there's only people like Job sort of experienced the devil, but he never actually seen him or heard him. The devil came and ruined his life so that he may curse God, but he never did. And he took away everything he had, which he didn't really do to me. The devil was just trying to make Job curse God with me. He came to me and he says, like, you've got to die before these things can happen, before the new world order comes, before a big explosion event happens on the earth, that he said. But I'll get into that. But like, Jesus experienced the devil, but he experienced the devil in a nice way. The devil actually came to him to try and coax him, to try and deceive, well, not deceive him, but to try and actually flatter him into worshipping him. And he says, you know, man child, Jesus Christ, human being, I'll give you all these things if you worship me. Well, why do, if you think you're God, then do this miracle and that miracle and to prove you're God. But he never, he never did. But he came to Jesus in a nice way. With me, he came literally, he said to kill, I need to die, I'm going to die before these events can happen. So I probably had it worse off than anyone else. And this is, really isn't any little voice in your head kind of thing. Yeah, little voice in your ears, or people around me, you know, being nasty. It's not that experience of evil. It was literally face to face, mouth to mouth. I could literally hear him, like I can hear that clear as that music is now, or clearer even. And so, yeah, so how it began though was a bit of sort of a bit of strife maybe. My life, you know, everything was unsettled a bit. I was off work at the time, and here's a good point. I was off work at the time, and work was, I wasn't in work for whatever reason, I can't remember what. I think it might have been sort of like stress and that, yeah. Well, you know, and I remember them saying that, you know, they wouldn't have me in, kind of thing. But now I look back at it, I was like, that was like God's hand, or whoever, but God's hand made my employer, not have me into work while this took place. And actually, just to cut a long story short, a as soon as this was ending on a Friday, this was a Friday, and you'll see why, they had me into work as soon as it had all finished. It was like, you know, God was in control, even of my employer. Do you know what I mean? So, it's so incredible, right? But how it all began. I actually went for a coronavirus test because I was feeling, like I said, I was feeling a bit groggy, a bit stressed and stuff like that. And then I started, like, hallucinating, sort of hearing, sort of, like music. And I was hearing, like, this sort of Slim Shady rapping going on. And I kept hearing it all the time, and I was like, wow. I was like, well, maybe that's because I used to listen to Slim Shady all the time. The voice was clear. And I remember actually going to the supermarket, tried to get some. I thought, oh, I just need a good sleep and a good rest. Went to the supermarket, actually, to say, have you got anything for hallucinations? And she's, yeah, I was like hallucinating, a bit stressed, and, you know, I'm feeling groggy and stuff like that. And they were like, oh, no, I don't. Didn't actually give me anything. I bought some sleeping tablets as well, just to, you know, try and send me off, like. But, yeah, this Slim Shady rapping was going on in the car, side of me, like this, coming out of the speaker kind of thing. And I remember actually saying, oh, haven't you got any Tupac? And the voice was like, Tupac's dead. You know, he's like, Tupac's dead, blah, 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 and then kept rapping. Kind of thing. And I was like, oh, bloody hell, it speaks back. And I was reading about hallucinations, and sometimes they say that, you know, you can speak back and stuff like that. So I was thinking, ah, maybe that's true then. But looking back at it, maybe hallucinations are not actually hallucinations as such. They're more like spirits talking to you, kind of thing. So that was like the first moment, and I didn't suspect anything at the time. And then I think probably the next event, maybe the same day even, I was lying on the couch in the living room, and I remember saying to my mum, I says, something spiritual's going on, because I can feel it, more like I can hear it, feel and hear it, because like my ears can pick up more sound, and you sort of get like a whirlwindy thing. I was sitting on the couch like that, and my whole body was just going to sleep. And you know, I could feel it, and that. But I didn't actually go to sleep, so I said, "Right, well, I'm going upstairs for a lie down." And this is the first illusion. And went upstairs for a lie down, sort of lying on my bed, sort of like the wrong way around as well, for whatever reason, I don't know. And then I felt like your presence in the room, kind of doing some sort of song, but I couldn't really hear it. And very faint, but in the corner of the room, and I was lying down. And then I sort of hearing like voices outside. And voices, this is one of the, well, this is the main point really, is that the illusions of Satan, the angel, or whoever this was, is audible. Audible illusions are so great. You can't even think. You might say, well, you can imitate the voice of your neighbour. You can imitate the voice of your neighbour and speak to you at the same time. You can imitate the voice of two of your neighbours, three of your neighbours, four, five, how many, all at once. Now, I don't know if it's his alone doing, but or if he has other angels or other demonic spirits around him. I don't know, but he did it. So, these illusions, like I say, it could be many spirits that are around at the time, you know, helping with him. Me thinking it's all him, but at the end of the day, that's all I knew was him. So, all these illusions, like neighbours talking outside, and neighbours sort of saying bad things about me. Bad things, well, maybe were true, some were true, and some were not true. And voices of neighbours from like across the road I've never even spoke to. And saying, let's go round and knock his door and get him out and all this sort of stuff. And you know, implanting in my brain something was going on and wrong, as if people are going to come around and lynch me kind of thing. And yeah, it sort of went on, and they were yapping as that. But then at this time as well, this presence in the room sort of held my feet down. Like, I hadn't heard this voice of this angel yet. So I thought, oh, maybe this is a good angel, you know, keeping my feet here to sort of just saying stay here, you know, safe here. But looking back at it, what he was doing is holding me there to sort of have the fear came to me. And yeah, the sort of talking went on, and I was just laying in bed with my feet stuck. And the illusions were, they came in my house, they knocked on my door, saying, I want to go upstairs and see, I want Justin, and my mum's voice, all illusion, saying, we can't come up, and then illusions, people outside saying, oh, there he is in his bedroom, and people coming, you know, knocking the door again and saying, oh, I want to see Justin. Well, this, I was listening to this, just laying still in the bed, thinking that this angel was protecting me, sort of thing, but I was fearful. But in actual fact, there was nothing on outside. But I just lay there, and hearing these illusions, obviously thinking, what the hell's going on, basically? Yeah, I'm like, who's after me? Why are they saying all these things, kind of thing, yeah? Is it my next door neighbour, or is it neighbour next to them, stirring shit up, like? So, that first illusion, I only realised that it was a illusion later on, because after lying in bed for all that time with these feet being held down kind of thing, I went downstairs and I said, well, come on then, what just happened? Who was at the door? And she was like, have you been dreaming? I was like, no, I've been awake the whole time. I was like, who was at the door? She was, oh, no one. I was like, just tell me, because I heard it, so just tell me the truth, stop lying. Just tell me who it was, like. And mother was like, oh, you've been dreaming, you have, or something, you know. Because obviously nothing happened. But it continued, you see. And I remember opening the window and hearing, like, voice illusions. Oh, there he is. And as if they were out the back of my house as well. And so that illusion sort of continued a bit. At that point, I remember it was getting dark. I'm not sure if it's the same night, but maybe it was. I would have thought so, actually. Is that sitting there watching the TV, and then so I did feel a presence, and then hear audible voice, and he was sort of the vibrations and sound that you get from the TV, he was kind of using that and like speaking at the same time, but obviously I could hear the difference, and he was sort of speaking as the TV was playing, if you know what I mean, sort of using that energy kind of thing, or using speakers. It felt like he was using the speakers, and it felt like he was really there, actually, because when my mother, because she sits right by the TV and she's on reclining chair like this, and then she twitches her foot like this, you know, or whatever, to something that was on TV, and then he's like, hey bitch, and then she's like twitching her foot, he's like, hey bitch, get your foot down, or whatever, like, hey bitch, that's all I could hear. In this Slim Shady voice, which is pretty weird, actually. He referred to himself as Shady as well. And, like I said, he was sort of communicating with me. And for earphones as well, he'd sometimes come up close and I could hear him sort of up close, communicating through the TV, interacting. He's answering questions for a game show. There was a film on that night, I think it was Kickboxer, and there was a thing at the end, and it's like singing along with the cheering that was going on and such like that. And he also, that night was the time that he referred to the King of England. And I said, "Oh, what about the Queen? You know, Queen of England. We've got a Queen. We haven't got a King at the moment." He's like, "Ah, bitch, blah 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 blah," as if she didn't exist. So, the way his presentation was that the Queen was gone, and the King of England was here. Which, if you watch my stuff, you'll see that when Prince William becomes King, then Seal One happens, and then it's the beginning of the end of the age. And in his mind, it's already done. So he's referring to the King of England. I was like, wow. And then sort of that night, I think just went to, you know, this was late night TV. Sort of went to bed, went to sleep. Everything was good, and I'm pretty sure it was probably the next day that everything come out in the light, so to speak, glorious. Summer day, you know, people out in the gardens and such. And then he just sort of come forward and spoke, you know, proper audible, not through like secondary vibration off sound or nothing, but by his own sort of voice. And it seemed like he was speaking better through speaker systems, because where I heard him most was through, there was a stereo in the kitchen actually. And he spoke, and he's like, you know, "I am one of the choir, one of, in the choir of angels," and some such. And he referred to himself as Metatron. And he says, "Look, look, move." And the stereo went like this. Obviously, probably the stereo didn't actually move. It's probably one of his illusions, but he's like, "Stereo, move." And it sort of moves like that. But like I said, and only I could hear and sort of see this, but more, he came audibly first. I was like, "Well, what's going on here? What do you want?" and sort of thing. And he's like, "There's going to be a major explosion event in one of the cities on the earth." And he says, "But you have to die before that happens. And I'm going to be staying with you until that happens." And I was like, "Whoa." I was like, "Well, is this the beginning of the end of the age, you know?" And I was like, "But I knew that this wasn't like a sacrifice." I thought, "This is not right." He didn't mention nothing about Jesus Christ or nothing like that. So I knew this angel was bad. But like I said, he referred to himself as Metatron. And he said, "There's going to be an event happen." And, you know, that day I was going about my business, and sort of went off to the shops, I remember, and he sort of flew into, well, I thought he flew in to the next door's garden, and he was singing and stuff and talking, and talking bad word, and he said bad word. But then their reaction was like, "Oh, don't talk to this thingy like that." And he's like, "Oh, right, sound." And he's sort of like, "Come out of the garden." I said, "That was bad, you should apologise for that." And he wrote, "Come in the car." And same thing, he could communicate more through the stereo system. I thought, anyway, though, this is how he perceived everything to be. And such like, that he could actually mix over the tunes that were there and put his own stuff in there. And obviously he's doing his own little singing and rapping and not too much then, actually. And just thinking, actually, because there was another time when it was quite minor. Might have been the same day, actually. I went up to prayer spot on the mountain, and I kept hearing these little audible voices. "Hey, kids over there," or whatever. And I was just like, there's no one here. And I was like, why am I hearing these hallucinations? It's probably, you know, just probably that same day, actually, or the day before. Why am I hearing these hallucinations? I went to sit down prayer spot praying. And I prayed and I said, "God, just reveal to me the truth about all these stupid little voice clips and hallucinations and such." I remember just as that happened, straight after, I was coming down the mountain and I heard the voice, Slim Shady voice, come back, talking to me, whatever. As Bauer, I can't really remember, we spoke, well, he spoke mostly, but yeah. And then it was like afterwards I thought, well, wow, you know, I spoke to God saying, show me the truth. And all these illusions stopped, and then the man himself, or whatever, angel himself came, and spoke to me direct in his Slim Shady voice. And yeah, that was one of the sort of minor things, I think, leading up to it, before I knew what it was, because afterwards I went into prayer spot, I knew exactly who he was, and he was following me up, and what the hell was this? And as he was following me up, he was just singing like these opera sort of singing, and on the way down he's saying, ah, he's going to kill me and everything else. But that was a little bit later on. But getting back to the sort of minor, yeah, that day he announces he's Metatron and choir of angels, and he's going to stick with me, and I'm going to die before these end of the age events begin, kind of thing. He didn't say end of the age, but that's what I sort of perceived it to be. And he's on my way to the shops, and he's like, come with me, in the stereo system speaking, or through the speaker system, whatever, in the shop. He's like going through the what I thought was a speaker system, and he's like, I'm shady, sort of like, you know, loads of shit, basically. And actually did the same in a different store. If you remember when I said I went for sleeping tablets, well, when I went to the pharmacy to ask them if they had anything with hallucinants, it seemed like he went up to the speaker system up there and he was speaking straight through it, and I thought, oh, can anyone hear this? But I don't believe they could. I think it was just me, but he's speaking clearly through the speaker system, it seemed. Maybe that is the point, because obviously a speaker takes energy and blasts it out into audible things that we can hear. So it might be exactly as it was. And yeah, that day, supermarket, speaker systems, come back home, and then he goes sort of into another person's sort of garden, and then he starts singing all these nursery rhymes, and then it's like a paedophilic sort of nasty sort of words to them, and he kind of, the neighbours' voices were like, what's going on here? And he kind of said to them, well, he implanted in my spirit, this is what he was doing, is that there was some sort of drone, and it was me on my computer going around doing it all. Do you know what I mean? And they was like, what the fuck, Justin, what the fuck? And then he went to another thing, he's like, what the fuck, Justin, and all this, yeah? And he sounds like he's going to all these gardens singing all these paedophile fucking nursery rhymes, and everyone's like, what the fuck, Justin? And then they was like, I'm gonna kill you Justin, and the next thing you know, I've got a whole neighborhood saying they're gonna kill me, sort of thing. So I was like, what the fuck? I freaked out, like, because although I'm a man of God, have been for 8 years, you know, 7.5 when this happened, and I've experienced spiritual things with angels before. I remember being in home and on my bed and having this sort of out of body type experience, having choirs of angels. It sounded like it was a choir of thousands of angels behind me, and I was so moved that I just literally, tears come down my face, couldn't move my body, but as tears come down my face, as these angels seemed like they were tracing my body, and they're all singing, and then hallelujah, hallelujah. And so I know what it's, you know, like to hear other things that are going on in the spiritual realm. And, you know, that night as well, after that happened, they played music that I used to like. I just dropped off and I woke up in the morning and I was, wow, it's the most amazing feeling after having such a scary experience at that time. So it wasn't new to connection with other, it's not really a connection to other realm, it's the realm being connected to us. We're living in it anyway. And like I said, there was choirs of angels, and I was just like singing, I was just crying with joy. But this time was sort of a lot different. And yeah. And so he's going around all his gardens, And everyone's like, I'm going to kill you, Justin. And the illusions were so great. It's not just sound. It's not just like a sound clip. It's like the vibration, the distance, the volume, everything about the illusions that Satan was doing was very realistic. Even the, like I said, the actual neighbours' voices, you know. So when people say they see ghosts and, oh, it was my grandmother speaking to me saying blah, blah, blah. It's Satan. It's Satan, definitely. No argument about it. If you can imitate like four neighbours' voices at the same time, then, you know, that says something, doesn't it? So, I remember actually going to the neighbour that you got on with next door, next door this way, and saying, oh, sorry about that, like, you know, coming into your stereo system. And he goes, we haven't got a stereo system outside. I was like, right. So that's why I think, at the time, I was like, like, you know, it's still going on, so I wouldn't stop and say, ah, oh, this is bollocks. You know, it's sort of like, well, hang on, what's going on here? And it was still happening. And so, yeah, but he was doing it so much that all I could hear was voices, like, from front, back, side to side. Oh, I'm going to kill you, Justin. So I freaked out. Well, because it sounded all real. All voices of neighbours that I either knew or didn't know. And so I freaked out. So I rang my dad, saying, oh, can I stay at yours for 2 days? Because he gave this thing about 2 days. He goes, start my new world order, but I've got to get rid of you first. And I asked him, I said, why do you want to kill me? Why do you want to get rid of me? Why are you doing it? He says, because you're a threat. You're a big threat to the new world order. That's what he said, new world order. He says, you're a big threat to the new world order. So just by that, even when I look back at it, you know, and I feel the spirit of peace and that come over me, it's like, well, if the devil comes to you to try and destroy you like that, then you must be important to the end of the age. So yeah, he says, you're a big threat to the new world order. That's what his thing, and you've got to go before this event happens. And within this time, he says, the angels are going to come down from heaven and take over the earth. That's what he said. The angels are going to come down from heaven and take over the earth. I was like, wow. I was like, well, I know that's going to happen anyway, because it says, Revelation, that the angels are going to get thrown down to earth. Well, Satan's going to get thrown down to earth, and all his angels are going to get thrown down with him. And at that point, they will rule the world, and for 3.5 years, at least, anyway. So I was like, well, this sounds real, but he thinks he's in control, when I know God's in control. And if you think about it now, you know, I'll just mention it quickly. If he still has his wings, which I'll prove later on that he does, then Revelation, where that hasn't happened yet, where the angels get thrown down. So, you know, and so he continued, and I was like, Dad's going to stay at yours. for a couple of days, and then, but I was still thinking in my head, oh, well, he's going to find me anyway, and maybe he'll send people around to Dad's house instead. I don't want to put him in danger. And Dad's like, you've been drinking again, or I said, I think the words that I use is something like, oh, this evil angel has just said that I've got to die before these events happen, and, you know, I've got to sort of get away. And he took ages to sort of get around anyway. I remember ringing his phone, and like the phone sort of went dead, like supernatural went dead, as if like rung off the hook sort of thing, like, and no connection, yeah, it was weird. And I'm saying, it's bouncing around all these houses still. So I get my Exodus bag ready, don't I? Get all my stuff into my bag. I was like, well, actually, no. Yeah, I'm not going to endanger my dad and my family. I'm just going to go. I can live in the wilderness for 2 days easily. You know, well, not so easily, but I'll take what I need. So I've got extras pack, you know, cover, tarp, whatever, blanket, change of grids, whatever, and stuff like that. And so I'm just going to go. My mum's watching all this stuff, thinking, me thinking he's lost his marbles. What, is an angel around trying to kill him? But yeah, that's it. I went down. So then, my dad still wasn't there, so I went outside and I was like, I'm bag on. I was thinking at the time there were going to be people outside, you know, sort of waiting for me kind of thing. Went outside, threw my bag in the car. So yeah, sort of gets into my car, ready. Well, as I was doing that though, I could only see like two neighbours, and not sure even if my dad just turned up. I can't remember actually. He might have just turned up and said, "What's going on?" So I sped off in my car and straight out, thinking, "All these neighbours are going to come after me because I heard all the voices of the neighbours." Do you know what I mean? And like, just again, these illusions were so great that it's hard even for a more than a true believer, pastor, prophet, you know, to believe in them. So, you know, these illusions were so great. I mean, it says that in the end times as well, about the illusions being so great they deceive many, but this was not written in the Bible, do you know what I mean? When the false prophet would be bringing down fire from heaven, I'll know. When they're trying to mark people with a chip, a micro, or whatever, mark of the beast, then I'll know, because it's all written, but this was not written. And this Metatron or whatever comes along. And so yeah, I just jumped in my car. With my Exodus back, sped off. Well, didn't speed off, but went off up the mountain. Towards the mountain, went to the car park. A bit further on from the car park, actually. I sort of tucked my car out of the way so people wouldn't be able to find it. Still, because like I said, the illusion was that great that it was in my head that these people, these neighbours were coming after me, kind of thing, for, you know, me droning this paedophilic sort of voice all around the neighbourhood, kind of thing. And I got on the Exodus pack, ready, on my back, went to switch my phone off, and then he was there with me. And he says, "Oh, that's no good, switching your phone up." I look at my phone, and there's a picture. Well, he was trying to say it's a picture of him, which I don't think it was. I mean, it was kind of a whitish guy, blondy hair, on the phone when it was off. And I was like, "Oh, this is just thingy." And he said, "Oh, you know, I've drained your battery now." And then, so I start walking up the mountain, just trying to remember about walking. Wasn't too much walking out. I thought he'd left me, like, and went back, you know, to my house. And he's saying that he's, you know, he's gonna get them all, lead them all up here and stuff like that. But get to the top of the mountain, and then that's when he sort of lands. I could hear his feet pitter patter. And he starts running at me like this and through me. And obviously, I wasn't scared because I know he spiritually can't hurt me, like physically. But the pitter-patter of the feet was just surreal. Nothing like you've ever known before. Imagine hearing that someone running at you like supernatural. And I was just like freaked out. And this was really trying to scare me now, like, kind of thing. I remember putting, I think it was my keys or my wallet or something, in the top zip pocket of my bag. And at this very time, where he's pitter-pattering and all that, his feet running at me. And they felt like big feet, they weren't small feet, like, he was like, sort of big, like, sort of like a medium size dinosaur, even, sort of feet, you know, big feet, like. And then I felt like He was trying to unzip the pocket of the wallet. Obviously, it could have just been an illusion as well, because, you know, physically, you can't really touch anything, I don't believe, but it felt like, oof, he was trying to get to my thingy, to get to my keys, and then, you know, entrap you even more, kind of thing. So I was like, oh, you know, trying to like, you know, trying to make sure the zip was thingy. But that's, like I said, that was the illusion. I carried on walking, just getting to the, kind of the, over the brink of the mountain already. And then, walking towards the, walking towards the top there, and then you've got the wall. And then he puts on his wings and he starts flying. In fact, couldn't actually never see him, but you can always feel and hear him. Even at the time when, like say he was on, oh he's not, when he was in my car, whatever. I could hear him fly off actually. Like that. At one time when it was really, when he was talking to me audibly, he just flew off like, yeah. And at one point he even said, look at that seagull, second one down. And I was like, and then, like that, yeah. And he's sort of like, well, I didn't actually hear, but he's like, poof. And then you see the seagull fly off as if he had some sort of like, you know. That was just another thing as well. And yeah, so we're at the mountain now and he starts flying. I was like, you know, why are you doing this? And he's like, you know, I told you, you got to go before I can start my new world order. And I was like, well, how are you going to start it? And he said something which was, the way he said it was a bit weird. Like, he said something like, I turn the stadium into a cloud of black dust, bloody blah. And he was in America. And I said, well, we're going to do that for, you know, kill a lot of people and stuff. And he said, I want to bring all the countries in for a new world order. I want to bring all the countries together. And I thought, man, well, why do you want to blow up a stadium and kill those people just for that, you know? And I was like, And then he's flying. And I was stood there at, on this like grass bit, and then there was a bit of a wall. And he was sort of flying in the valley that's over the wall kind of thing. And, you know, we're talking all the time. Can't remember exactly, but this is this is another thing as well. He couldn't, I didn't have to talk like that. He could read your mind. He could think something like, why are you doing this? And he'll hear it and he'll respond, because blah blah blah, because you're a threat to the new world order. And then he could think something and then he'd hear it and then he'd speak back. So it was like telepathy. So, you know, trying to outsmart some being like that is obviously out of human control. And, you know, how incredible is that, that, you know, the spiritual world that we don't even know of, like. And, like I say, he's flying about and just talking and stuff. And I thought, I'm just gonna hide it out here for two days. And he's like, well, I'm going to go back now and you're going to send thingy, and he's going to rape your mother and kill her and everything else and all this shit. And I was like, oh well. And so, and then it's sort of getting dark and I thought, well, I better hunker down now. And, you know, so I had a little spot, still fearing that people were coming after me kind of thing. And then that's when another illusion came. And it was so good that, you know, like a dog chain and people walking. Imagine two dog holders, like two dog, you know, like coming with dogs to sniff you out. Well, imagine what noises you'd hear. You'd hear rustling of feet, you'd hear the dog chains and stuff like that. Exact illusion. And I was like, there's people there, there's people there. But there wasn't. That's one illusion. And then I was like sort of unsettled, and he's still flying around. And then we go off into the wilderness. And I said, I'm you know, going to push on a bit and find somewhere else, you know. And then as I was walking up, I could hear like, hey, there he is. Or there he is, Baba. And I'm like looking around, who is it? Because there's another thing, like as he's flying, he's doing these illusions, like as if he's just pointing at a spot and say, stay that, snip it. Hey, there he is. That's the way and he'd be over here, he's finding this valley on the left, and these illusions happen way over here up on the right. And like I said, the sound and the vibration of it was perfect, as if there was someone there, but there wasn't. So I just sort of ended up walking all the way up and talking and stuff like that. I remember asking him one question, actually. Well, not one question, I asked him quite a lot of questions, but I remember asking him, did you create Sunday worship? And he said, no, I didn't create Sunday worship, I adopted it. Which says one thing, that Sunday worship is part of the synagogue of Satan. Sunday worship of the Roman Church is of Satan, and he owns it now. But I knew he was lying anyway, because Revelation says that in the time of Antipas, a faithful witness that was killed where Satan's seat is, and where Antipas was killed, the seat where, I think it was in Turkey, around that area, but it was the Roman Empire. Yeah, so I know at that time, even Satan's seat was in the Roman Empire, you know, even before Revelation was made, which was, you know, in 90-something AD. So I was like, hang on a minute, your seat's been there since then. I know the Sabbath was created about 300 years after that, but you know what I mean, he lied, but he said he adopted it. But he's bullshit, he created it, and it's his now. Sunday worship is of Satan, by, you know, his own words. Like. And it got to a point where I was like, do I really want to be staying out here tonight? And I was thinking, you know, because it's top of the mile and it's a lot colder and stuff like that. And so I sort of like, I'll bugger it, I'll walk back and kill a bit of time and maybe hunker down somewhere. So walking back, like. And at that time, he was singing a song. It was like something like Friday and Saturday and Sunday and Monday. And what he's actually saying is that Justin's gonna die on a Friday. This is gonna die on a Friday. And we're walking back, but now he's walking with us. With me, sorry. Walking, not flying. And in a sort of audible voice. And remember there's some sort of ranger guy. And I asked him, oh, where's that path lead to? And he's like, oh, Rowan or someone like that. And I was like, okay. And as we passed, though, Satan had it in his spirit to sort of deceive me to think that he just told them that I had a gun on me. And he's like, And then I was thinking that this guy was coming after us, thinking I had a gun, police or whatever. I thought, well, if I get arrested and I'd be in a cell, then, you know, it's not good, is it? And so I just started walking back. And he made this thing, he was like, in an audible voice. And there were actually people there. Pretty sure they were, you know, real, not an illusion, like. But after dark, he does get visual illusions after dark. But, yeah, there's people there, and he's like, an audible voice, like, get down, he's got a gun, he's got a gun, get down on your knees, he's got a gun. Everyone on your knees. But the people actually looked round like that, as if they could hear it too, you know, so it was a bit weird, that one. So, so then, yeah, walked back anyway, and went back all the way to the car. Remember ringing my mum, and I said, like, is everything okay there? Like, the neighbour's not going mad or anything? She's like, no, no. I was like, you sure? And you checked, like, she's like, no, nothing's going on here. I was like, okay, fine. So I remember getting back to the car and thinking, well, my chance going home then, or sleep in the car or whatever. And then he was still there, and he was just fannying about doing things. And sort of walk down the hill and stuff and that, and remember he was like singing or something, and he jumped on, well, it seemed like he jumped on a cart, and the cart went all the way up the road with him singing. And then he jumped on another car to come down, and he's coming back down again and singing and stuff, and flew off. It was a bit crazy, like. I was like, oh, I'm going back home. I thought I'd get something to eat first, and then went back. So I went back home. And then he was saying that, well, I've got, he says, I'm like, it'll be Friday that you die, and that. And all that, and I was thinking, it was only Sunday. And I was thinking, oh, I got put up with him all week until Friday, you know, trying to kill me off and stuff. So, yeah, I jumped home, went and got a shower, I think, that day. And then he was with next door neighbours again, and he was like, oh, I just seen Justin's winky, little tiny penis, and something like that. And you see all the kids responding. But like I said, this is all illusion. And I was saying to my parent, I was like, I can't stay here. I have to go away. I'll go away for a week. Packing my stuff and everything, yeah. Clothes and that. Because I thought, if I at least go away, then he's not going to have the power of people around here that, you know. So, yeah, I remember grabbing some of my Exodus stuff. And it was like when I touched it, it was kind of like his voice, like a sort of voice snippet. It's a bit like an alarm system. If you put, I think it'd go beep 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 beep, which is like a voice going. I was like, shit, he's put like a marker on these goods, as if to know that, oh, he's taking his Exodus stuff. That means he's going away. This is stuff like extras, like first aid and stuff like that. I've got in little plastic bags. And so he's putting like his markers on, and then he's like, what are you doing? You're going away, and all this shit. And he starts talking all this dark stuff. And then I just decided not against it. And thought, no, I won't bother. And then, thinking that same day, I think I went to my mate's house. And went around to his house, knocked on the door. And then I seen like this illusion, like a visual, but it was like sound as well. I seen my mate at the top of the stairs going, like that. I was like, what's going on? Lock the door. And Satan's like, I put a spell on that house. And when your mate gets home, he's going to die. Basically, yeah. Well, he might have told me that after, actually, because I drove down the road. My mate was coming up the hill. I was like, oh, what are you doing? And all that. And I was like, you know, I got put up with this guy. And then try and, my mate said after, he says, oh, you seemed a bit, strange, like a bit weary, and that. And then after seeing him, I think that's when he said, yeah, when your mate gets home, he's gonna die. So I did a sort of a loop round. I rang him and I says, have you gone in your house yet? He's like, no. I was like, oh, don't go in your house, I'll be there now. And then as I was going there, and he's like, he's dead. I was like, shit, you know, he's gone in the house, he's had a heart attack, whatever. But got there, like, and I got there, and he's like, standing outside. I was like, been in the house yet? He's like, no. I was like, all right, let me pray against. So I prayed against the house, like, saying, you know, any spells that have been put on his house, like, be gone in Jesus' name and everything else. And he's like, what's wrong with you? What's going on? Like, you know, I know you're religious and that, but, you know, this is a bit crazy. And I was like, well, you know, there's an angel, Satan or one of his angels, whatever, with me. And he said he put a spell on the house that if you go, when you go in it, you're going to die, like. And he's like, oh, that's crazy. I was like, yeah, I know, yeah. It was a fucking nightmare. And so that was all right. But one of the things Satan didn't like was me telling people about him and that. Yeah. Because another thing as well, I was driving out of my car. got to drive away from my house to get away from all the shit that was going on. And he was like, where are you going? Go get back home and all this sort of stuff. I pulled over and I told him, I was like, there's an evil angel in this car, like, and he's trying to kill me off. And the person's like, are you sure you're right? And he's like, yeah. He's like, what are you trying to do? And then, as I was driving along, he's like this, sort of as if they're pulling the steering wheel. You know what I mean? I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And he's like, woo, sort of revving the engine and sort of thing, as if he's pushing the pedal and all this. And I'm thinking, well, this guy could even have control of the car, that, you know, he could smash it into something. And I was thinking, well, but it could, like I say, it's probably all illusion. He probably was never moving the steering wheel, never touching the pedal, never move the stereo and everything. It's probably all illusion, but it was very real to me, like. So, yeah, that day, left my mate's house, went back home. And then he was appearing more. He's still chatting with his little, his neighbour friends, like. And he's appearing more like a whirlwind, then could feel him, you know, thinking he's like, oh, he's outside. And they come back in and stuff. And I said, ah, oh, bugger this, I'm going downtown and have a few drinks or something and just forget about it. He's like, you're not going anywhere. And I'm like, yeah, I'm, see you later. He goes, well, when you get back home, your mother will be dead and all this. I'm like, just do what you got to do, innit? So I went off. He followed me. Went to Conway, had a few drinks, well, had a few cans, and just sat there, like, and could hear him whistling around with his little whirlwind, and he's singing to himself, and he's just, whoosh, as if he's going around a little bit. And it was as if he was planting, like, a spell, you know, like a Hate Justin spell, all over the town. And I was like, all right, fine. And, yeah, that day, like, I went down to the bottom field, come up the steps, and he's doing like a vocal illusion. Hey, hey, Justin, what the fuck are you doing? Like, get a voice of someone that I've been get on with, kind of thing. I was like, oh, well. So I sort of ran up the steps. And then went down to one of the pubs there and just sat there and had a pint, like. And one of my mates actually was there, and I was having a pint with him. And then suddenly Satan just turns up and sits right next to him. And then he's talking to me, like, what are you doing here? And just talking to me. And I'm just trying to talk to my mate, but not, like, make it known that he's, you know, sitting right there talking to me as well. So it's crazy. And then after I left the pub, he was kind of going around all the... seemed like he's going around all the streets sort of doing this Curse Justin sort of thing all around it. So I went up Sochran Passway, which is a different way home, up the mountains. And there was a visual illusion. There was a visual illusion that there was a big block of bricks that had been moved there, like this. And thing is, where that is where a corner of a wall is, as if they were going to move the wall out and then smash into him with my car if he goes like that, kind of thing, you know what I mean? And it's weird, kind of look in the garden, you see like these gargoyle rock things with these, a bit like the Easter Island things, but more sort of not as long. And so I was thinking, what? And then I seen two people in the garden, like a fire going, and I was thinking, oh, these are like Satan's servants, these, aren't they? I was like, wow. And I start preaching to him, man. I'm like, he'll never save you. He's going to hell. He's going to the lake of fire. He's going to take you with you. Like, be saved in Jesus' name and everything else. I'm preaching to these people. There probably wasn't even anyone there. Do you know what I mean? It's probably a visual illusion. And then, yeah, I walked on like that. And actually, some guy stopped and he was looking for somewhere. I was like, oh, I can show you where that is. And then he gives me a lift, but then... he couldn't keep me in the van at the same time as picking these people up or something like that. So I get dropped off and then walking back home. And Satan comes, like, he goes, oh man, I'm angry with you, I'm angry with you. I was like, oh yeah, why? He goes, you know, you've upset. You're trying to upset my people, trying to take my people away from me and all this. I'm like, alright, so fair enough. And then as we're like, walking through the estate, but he does something like knocks a door or smashes something up or pretends to smash something over. I'm like, fucking, not running away, but walking away. And he's like, hey, do you know Justin Roberts? And the guy's like, yeah. He's like, oh, it was him that did it. Pretty pathetic, like, but. And I was like, this guy's a fucking wanker. So I walk home, and it's the end of another night. And at some point, because they couldn't find my laptop charger at one point, I thought someone had been into the house and stole it, or he'd, sent someone in the house and stole it. Couldn't find it anyway. And there's lots of other illusions that, people waiting outside the house. So I have some of my people outside the house. Went outside and I looked at my neighbour's car and there were two people sat in the car just staring, like, it was just an illusion. And another person across the road, like, looking out the car as if he had a weapon, like a sort of gun or something. And I was like, this is mad. Neighbours, if they were climbing over the wall and stuff to get me, and I was just going mental, getting all my weapons out and stuff, like, ready for battle. And, that was end of another day. Just trying to think how I wrapped up that. And then, another thing, he was singing with the neighbours, and they were all singing. It was almost like they were in witchcraft. And they were all singing, like, Justin's gonna die on a Friday. Justin's gonna die on Friday. Justin's gonna die on a Friday. Justin's gonna die on a Friday. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Like that. And I was like, wow, even the neighbours are planning this now, like, or in cahoots. And so, I was like, days gone on. I think we're into Monday, Tuesday, whatever it was. I think then it started to phase out a bit, and I was like, another thing is, he's like, don't tell anyone about this, don't tell anyone about this. So when I'm messaging people, just, single message, saying, what's happening, he's seen it, and then he's like, might have even been Sunday, I'm not sure. He's like, and then transforms from this Slim Shady into what sounded like a red dragon, because he was literally roaring, and it was like sort of pulsating music, and sort of Quasimodo kind of stuff, like, deep sort of like the organy sort of music that's all behind him. And he's like, and he's speaking like dead loud, anger me and all this. And then he's like, do you not think I can send one of the lunatics from the estate round to kill you? And at that time, there's a vocal illusion outside saying, I can see the fucking bear you're sitting in now, fucking kill the lawyers. Proper shouting, like, as if they were outside. And I was like, yeah, you could, but whatever's going to happen is going to happen. And he's like, and he started talking about, like, a lake of fire, and I was like, well, it's written in the Bible that you will be going to the lake of fire, mate, after the 1,000 years. And he's like, I won't be going to the lake of fire. I was like, yeah, you are. He's like, please, no. And he's like, will you pray that I don't go to the lake of fire? Almost like he's crying. I'm like, I don't know, it's written, but I suppose things can change. But, he's like, pray that I won't go to the lake of fire. I'm like, whatever kind of thing. He's like, pray that won't go to the lake of fire, in his sort of dragony voice. And then he's going on for quite some time. As I step towards him as well, he kind of moved back, which is weird, actually, isn't it, thinking about it? Because here he is, this big red dragon, and there's me as a saint, and I step forward, and he has to step backwards, because he stepped backwards that he was behind the window, so I couldn't hear what he was saying. I was like, I can't hear what you're saying, mate. You have to step forward. I can't hear what you're saying, mate. You have to step forward. And by the way, you know, people are going to say, oh, you should just rebuke him in the name of the Lord. Plenty of times I said, I rebuke you in the name of the Lord. But if you think about it, listen, if God allowed him, like God allowed Job, and God allowed Satan to go to Jesus to try and tempt him, you know, why didn't God try and stop Satan from trying to tempt Jesus, and then there would be no saviour? You know what I mean? But God allowed it. So God allowed him to come to me. So me saying I rebuke him in the name of the Lord, well, if the name of the Lord, if the Lord has even said, well, it's okay, you know, go and try and test or go and try and but what I realised was that he has no hand over me or over anyone else. And I remember another night, it was actually my birthday night. So 11th of August this would have been. So, you know, that would have been 11th of August. That would have been a Tuesday. And this is towards the end as well. And there's two people in the lab, pub. There's social distancing as well. And one of the lads goes, oh yeah, well, I'm a Satanist. I'm proud to be a Satanist. Oh, that's what I'm thinking. Oh yeah, these lads are here for me, you know what I mean? So we kind of walked away, but I was like, walk back up, because I was curious to, you know, if there's going to be an attack, a scrap or whatever, then I was just going to take it, kind of thing. And I think that was like one of the last nights that he was there. And yeah, on that day that he sort of transformed into the red dragon, I went to the shop, so he came with me, kind of thing. But then as I went back from the shop, he sort of disappeared and came back again, and then he sort of singing all these sort of opera classic-y sort of song, almost like you someone's funeral or someone's end or something like that. And I was thinking, was that me? What's he doing? But I just thought, well, what's going to happen is going to happen, isn't it? And yeah, he was still doing the chants. I just didn't get on the night on a Tuesday. It's Friday. And so, yeah, but I think about Wednesday, it started to fizzle out. But there was still things, like, burning. Because I was saying, well, I just won't be there. I just won't be in my house on Friday. You know? And he was like, well, I just have the house burnt down with your mother in it. And I was like, all right. And then he's like, sound clip it, so burning house and screaming, burning house and everything like that. And I thought in my head, well, if he's going to try and send his people around, then I'll just take him up to the field, and just like Elijah, will bring down fire from heaven and just devour them, you know. And I think after that it sort of fizzled out, and I had great peace, and I thought, well, if they're going to fight me, I'll fight back with God, you know. And I think that was probably one of the last times, went on a bit of a road trip that day, me and Mum. But he came back to us, he was speaking for the speaker system. Couldn't really say what hear what he was saying, but it was more like, shit, fucking, yeah, blah, 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 you're gonna die. He was swearing and all that kind of thing. And then, next few days, little snippets. But he could have even left these snippets, you know what I mean? I don't know. And then just fizzled out. And then, weirdly, as it fizzled out, on a Thursday, my work sort of contacted me and says, oh, are you okay for work on Friday? We were desperate for people. I was like, okay. Yeah, I'd literally just overcome this thing, and they wanted me in. And when working on Friday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, for about 2 weeks then, it was literally ecstasy. It was like everyone was happy, everyone was loving, smiling. Even it was like, you know, sort of drive past, and like girls were smiling at me and, you know, looking at me, sort of thing. And I was like, whoa, hang on a minute, this is affecting everyone. It's not just me feeling ecstasy, proper energy, as if I was king of the castle. Like, everyone's responding, everyone's getting on with each other, everyone's having a laugh and everything. It was just like a massive, like, Holy Spirit, like, as if there were angels around, sort of touching everyone. It was so amazing, like, and, you know, I was like, is this going to be forever? And I was like, this can't be forever. But no, I believe that, like, God sent his angels afterwards, like it says in the Bible about Jesus. Satan left him, and angels attended him. So even Jesus Christ, the Saviour, the Son of God, even angels had to attend him after his encounter with the devil. So it was just the same with me. Straight after it finished, you know, before Friday, whatever it was, it was almost like angels came and they touched me, they touched everyone around me and everything else, and everything was just like ecstasy. It was literally ecstasy, like heaven on earth is such a thing. Everyone was getting on with each other. And that was just as incredible as the bad stuff, because it was like how much evil and how much illusions and delusions and deceivement and lying and planning and everything else. And then you have this flip side of such amazing love and grace and ecstasy and companionship, fellowship. Everyone was just getting on with each other, and everyone was just boom. And then obviously that fizzled out, and then everything went back to normal. But, you know, having the experience of this has been, well, is what is most scary. Well, obviously, if I'm on the phone here saying there's evil angels trying to kill, there's an evil angel trying to kill me, Dad, I need to get out of here. Got my ex that's back jumping in my car, going up the mountain and going to sleep. You know, imagine how scared I was for me to do all that. Obviously, adrenaline going and everything else. It wasn't just a quiet whisper in the ear. Another thing is that sometimes you'd, if it wasn't, sometimes you'd speak in this side of my voice and say, I love you, I love you, I love. It might not have been him, it might have been another angel saying, I love you, I love. Different voice, but pretty similar. And then at the same time, you could, in this side of the ear, be like, oh, look at you and your scraggy clothes and you haven't got a girlfriend and all this sort of stuff. Like, that was when I was lying down. I remember lying down, I thought, if I just go to sleep, just carry on, you know, going to sleep, maybe have a few drinks, go to sleep, you know, and just wade it out, that'll be. But then I was trying to sort of go to sleep, and he's like, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, get up, wake up. Couldn't go to sleep like that, you know. So yeah, it's most incredible. Most incredible. And how real it was unreal. It's hard for me to explain it. And you just think, ah, it's just in your head, you know. And he's like, well, it wasn't in my head. It was out there speaking at me. You know what I mean? He was even answering questions on a TV show. Obviously getting them right, because, you know, he's got much more higher knowledge and spirit of, you know, everlasting beings and such like. And so, yeah, that's pretty much all of the experience. I know I've gone on a bit on all the videos. I just wanted to get, like, a full disclosure of what happened, and I don't think there's anything I missed out on. Yeah, most of the times he seemed like he was speaking or amplifying himself more through his speaker systems, threatening death, making me known of people that were either were his or were not his. But I knew that in the end of it, I knew that he didn't even have the power to have one single finger put on me. Which, you know, I can take that forward in life and think no one can put a finger on me, because God's protection was always there. And afterwards, you know, praise God, and quite incredible, really. Like I said, I've had encounters with angels before, good angels, and it wasn't, well, it was intense in a different way, obviously not a scary way, but yeah. And then afterwards, the angels attended me, attended us, whatever, all people around me, and that ecstasy was great. And if the 1,000 years can be like that ecstasy I had then, It's going to be amazing, I tell you. You know, shorter than actually taking ecstasy. You know, I'm feeling that everyone's in love and having that, you know. You know, it'd be amazing if it was like that. So, yeah, hopefully I'll get this uploaded. It's always been in my head about my, you know, my contending with the devil, yeah. Oh, and that's another thing as well, that when I was talking to him, as he was transformed into a fiery dragon, whatever it was, fiery dragon, he actually referred to himself as the king of hell. Now, hell being Hades, the underworld. So, if you say he's king of the underworld, you know, is Satan king of the underworld? Obviously, the underworld, hell, is not the same as the lake of fire either. But there is a being in the Bible that's referred to as Hades. Hades and death were cast into the lake of fire. So, I don't know. If this was the angel that was called Hades, then, you know, he was just as bad. Or if it was the devil himself saying he's king of hell, then same thing, really. Another thing is that I realised that the angels, he still had his wings, could hear him fly. So then Revelation 12, where the angels get thrown down to earth, Satan and his angels get thrown down to earth. I knew that hasn't happened yet, because he still has his wings. I heard him flying. If he's been thrown down by Michael, he's lost his wings. That was another thing, is that I knew that Revelation 12, that part, hadn't happened yet. So that was another great thing that I brought from it. I was like, that hasn't happened yet, so we're still in that point. So, yeah, I think that's about all, really. Yeah, so I've been Pastor Prophet Justin Roberts for End of the Age Bible Prophecy. God bless you all. Amen.